Hello everyone and welcome back to the module 2 decision tree learning session in machine learning. So we are here at the last subtopic of the decision tree representation, that is hypothesis space search in decision tree learning, inductive bias in decision tree learning and issues in decision tree learning. So in the earlier class we have learnt about decision tree representation, or we call it as the formulation of a decision tree. So which will be the root node, then the leaves, then from that from the branches another nodes will be generated, by which we will be finding out which will be the which attribute will be having the maximum gain value. So that maximum gain value attribute will become the root node, and next maximum gain value attribute we will search for from the branches, so that attribute will become the next node for further branching. So after that, in hypothesis space search, say search space in decision tree learning, that is what we call it as, or else we call it as hypothesis space search in decision tree learning. Say something like a search space is made by a partial decision tree where the algorithm is hill climbing. So always we will go from top to bottom, or else we call it as here bottom up approach. So there are two approaches in decision tree learning. One is either top down approach or else bottom up approach. Say the algorithm will be hill climbing whenever your leaf nodes are split into sub branch or sub trees, right? So the evaluation function is information gain, what we are using in decision tree. So the hypothesis space will be complete when it represents all the discrete value functions. So discrete valued functions are nothing but the Boolean functions, that is true or false. Then the search will maintain a single current hypothesis. The search will maintain a single current hypothesis, whereas there will be no backtracking. So we cannot go for backtracking. So there is no gap guarantee for the optimality. So when you cannot go for backtracking, then there will be no guarantee for optimality, and it uses all the available examples, whereas it is not incremental. So it will be using only the available in examples, and it will not increment, or it will not use another example, that means incremented example. So, and it may terminate earlier or accept the noisy classes. So the tree may terminate earlier itself, or else it may accept noisy classes. So this is the representation of the tree. Now what is inductive inference in the decision tree? That is inductive bias, what we have learnt in the first module also, right? So here also the same thing we will be representing for decision trees, that is inductive inference with the decision trees. That is, decision trees is one of the most widely used and practical methods of inductive inference. So which has got the features like a method for approximating discrete valued functions, which includes Boolean functions. Again, it is a repetition, that is true or false. Then learned functions as represented decision trees, that is if then else and rules which are there, and so on. Then expressively or expressive hypothesis space, including disjunction and conjunction, etc. And robust to the noisy data. If it is containing noisy data, then it will be robust. Next, again, inductive bias in decision tree has a question like, what is inductive bias of decision tree learning? So there are two answers for this question, like what is inductive bias of decision tree learning. First answer is, it goes for shorter trees as preferred over the longer trees. Instead of longer trees, it will go for, or it will prefer shorter trees, which is not good enough for where the bias is exhibited by a simpler breadth first search algorithm, or you call it as BFS. So breadth first search algorithm generating all decision trees, selecting the shorter one, where it will select only the shorter ones and it will not prefer the longer ones. Another answer is, the second answer is, it will prefer the trees that place high information gain. So that is like the gain value which is more for that particular attribute. That means it will place an high information gain attribute close to the root. So always the root node will be having the high information gain value. Note that decision trees are not limited to representing all possible functions. So all possible functions are not the limitation for representing the decision tree here. Now there are two kinds of biases. So first kind of bias is preference or search bias, and second one is restriction or language bias. So first one is preference or search bias is due to search strategy, where ID3 algorithm searches a complete hypothesis space and the search strategy is incomplete. That means when you go with ID3 search algorithm, the complete hypothesis space has to be searched and the search strategy will be incomplete. It cannot be completed. Whereas when you go for second one, that is restriction or language bias, so due to the set of hypotheses which are expressible or considered, then we will be using candidate elimination algorithm here, or the candidate elimination search. So that is what we have discussed in the first session, the first module also, Findus algorithm and candidate elimination algorithm. So here also candidate elimination search algorithm will be an incomplete hypothesis space, where the search strategy will be complete. For incomplete hypothesis space, candidate elimination search will be applied, where it will be a search strategy for complete search strategy. Whereas if you go for an ID3 search algorithm, where it has got complete hypothesis space, but search strategy will be incomplete. So the combination of both the bias learning in a linear combination of weighted features for board games will be well applicable or well suited for board games. So why to prefer shorter hypothesis? So why we prefer shorter hypothesis with respect to Occam's razor? So we prefer shorter hypothesis with Occam's razor. So why we prefer shorter hypothesis? There are two arguments in favor and against this why we prefer short hypothesis. The arguments which are favor with respect to the shorter hypothesis is there are fewer shorter hypotheses than the longer ones. So we will get fewer short hypotheses than the longer ones. So longer ones will be more. If a short hypothesis fits data, unlikely to be a coincidence. So whenever you have short hypothesis where the data fits, which will be like a coincidence. Whereas we argue against that, then not every shorter hypothesis is reasonable one. That means every short hypothesis cannot be a reasonable one for all types of data. Now in brief, if we describe what is Occam's razor. So Occam's razor is, if you have two theories that explains the observed facts, then you should be using the simplest until more evidence is represented or which will come along with. That means the simplest explanation for some phenomena is more likely to be accurate than more complicated explanation. So whenever you have a simplest explanation for some phenomena which is more likely to be accurate than the complicated explanation, that means it is as simple as that. So when you are told reach a particular place, right? Say from Mysore to Bangalore via Srirangapatnam, Mandya, Madur, Ramnagar and Biddi, then that is the simplest route. Then if you make it a complex one, like if you go to Hassan, then if you go to Chennaipatna, then if you go to Tumkur, then you come to the Bangalore, then that will be the complex route. So when you have a simplest explanation, instead of that, if you make it a complicated, then it will not be considered when simplest explanation is accurate for that particular phenomenon. Next is, if you have two equal likely solutions for a single problem, then you need to choose the simplest, right? So when you have two different solutions for a single problem, both are giving the equal amount of accuracy for the particular problem, you need to choose the simplest out of those two. Then the last one is, the explanation is requiring fewest assumptions is most likely to be corrected. Where you have fewer assumptions and the answer is most likely it is correct. Now the last part of the decision tree representation is with respect to issues in decision tree learning. So that is there are 5 different issues in decision tree learning, which includes avoiding of overfitting the data. So avoiding the overfitting data has reduced error pruning and rule post pruning. So I will explain what is pruning later. Then second method is with respect to incorporating continuous valued attributes. So incorporating continuous valued attributes will also be an issue in decision tree learning. Next, alternative measures for selecting attributes, then handling training examples with missing attribute values, then handling attributes with different or differing cost. Now, what is overfitting? So, overfitting definition is building trees that adapt too much to the training examples may lead to overfitting. So, when you have built a data set and the tree is built to fit, say, some example for about 100 data sets, if you fit more than that, so 101, 102, and so on, more than that, then it will be adapting for too much of training. So then it will be leading to an example for overfitting. So if you consider the hypothesis H, where the training data error D of H is there, we call it as empirical error, then the entire distribution X of the data error X will be expected as, or you call it as expected error. So error D you call it as empirical error, and error X you call it as expected error. Say then hypothesis H will be overfitting or overfits the training data if there is an alternative hypothesis H dash which belong to the hypothesis capital H, such that error, that is empirical error, is lesser than the empirical error of H dash, and expected error H dash is less than the expected error H. That means H dash behaves better over unseen data. So if you take the same example of outlook, temperature, humidity, wind, and playing tennis for the respective days, so we were calculating the attribute values, etc., for 14 days, that is day 1, day 2, up to 14. Now the overfitting data is like the last row, D15, sunny, hot, normal, strong, and then still playing tennis is no. When it is sunny and it is hot, then normal and wind is strong, etc., and you will say playing tennis is no. Whereas for the attribute outlook, sunny is already there with respect to D1, D2, D8 and D9 and also D11. So in these are the parameters which are there already present for the attribute outlook, that is sunny. So if you are adding one more row for sunny, then it will be the overfitting. Now overfitting in decision tree is like outlook, sunny, overcast, again rainy. From sunny it will be splitted with the node humidity as high, normal, no, and yes, and so on. Now from outlook it is sunny, for temperature it is hot, for humidity it is normal, and for wind it is strong, and playing tennis is no. Now new noisy example is included. That means new noisy example causes splitting of the second leaf node. So here when you come to the last leaf node, that is after humidity, high, normal, no or yes, then probably it will make it to split into one more leaf node, that is the second leaf node. Now if you represent it graphically, then the overfitting decision is represented here in the graph, that x-axis, like, it represents the size of the trees, or else you call it as the number of nodes, and y-axis it will represent the accuracy. So here in the graph it has been represented like there are two curves. So one curve is with respect to the exponential, which is going with the accuracy wear on the training data set. So the first curve is you can observe there, which is on the training data set, which is having the best accuracy, or the accuracy of the nodes is good. Now when you test the same on the data set, right, on the test data, then the accuracy will come down for the number of nodes when you have overfit data, right, which is shown in dotted lines. There are two different strategies to avoid overdrifting. So first one is you need to trim off, or you need to stop the growing tree earlier itself. So you need to cut down the tree which will be growing at the earlier stage itself. So before perfect classification, before classification you need to trim off the tree. The trimming or cutting off or stopping the tree, stopping the growth of the tree is called as pruning, or you call it as prun. So then second step is to allow the tree to overfit the data, and then you do the trimming, that is post prun the tree, right? So one is before tree gets grown and classification is done, you need to trim it off. Otherwise you allow it to overfit the data and then you do the post prun of that particular tree. So whereas the training and validation set will be like, you will be splitting that, or else you will be split the training into two parts. One is training and validation, and you will be using the validation to assess the utility of post pruning. So whereas post pruning has two steps, one is which it will be an reduced error pruning, and another one is rule pruning. So reduced error pruning and rule pruning. Another approach or different approaches are there which we can use for avoiding the overfitting. That is, we can use statistical tests to estimate the effect of expanding or pruning. Another one is you can go with minimum description length principle, which uses a measure of complexity of encoding the decision tree and the examples. Where it halts or stops the growing of the tree when this encoding size is minimum or which is minimal. Now, reduced error pruning. So, a reduced error pruning was done by Quinlan in 1987. So, pruning is, as I told, it is cutting or trimming of the overgrown branches of the tree. That means the nodes. So, each node is a candidate of pruning. So, pruning consists of removing a subtree rooted in a node, whereas the node becomes the leaf and assigned the most common classification. So, nodes are removed only if the resulting tree performs no worse on the validation set. Otherwise, the nodes are pruned iteratively. At each iteration, the nodes will be pruned. So, the node will be whose removal of most increases accuracy on the validation set is pruned. Then, pruning stops when no pruning increases accuracy. So, no pruning increases accuracy means then you need to stop the pruning. Now, this is the effect of reduced error pruning. So, in the earlier graphical representation, we just checked with the training set and test set. Now, this is with respect to reduced error pruning. The graph line which is there almost like a straight line just above the test data, that is on test data during pruning, right? So the center line which is there, that is like called as pruning data set or pruning test data. Now, what is the brief definition of overfitting? Overfitting occurs when a statistical model or machine learning algorithm captures the noise of the data, and overfitting occurs when the model or algorithm fits the data too well. And specifically, overfitting occurs if the model or the algorithm shows low bias with high variance. So, low bias with high variance, and overfitting is often the result of an excessively or complicated model. And it can be prevented by fitting multiple models and using validation or cross-validation to compare their predictive accuracies on test data. The other part is underfitting. After overfitting, the other part is underfitting. So, underfitting occurs when a statistical model or machine learning algorithm cannot capture the underlying trend of the data. So, that is, underfitting occurs when the model or the algorithm does not fit the data well enough. So, specifically, the underfitting occurs in the model or algorithm shows low variance and high bias. So, whereas in overfitting it is high variance and low bias, here low variance and high bias. So, underfitting is often a result of an excessively simple model. So, both overfitting and underfitting lead to poor predictions on the data set. Now, this is the graphical representation of overfitting and underfitting. The first one is underfitting, where which is represented with respect to the axis time and values. So with respect to that, you have underfitted values here in the first graphical diagram. In the last graphical representation, you have overfitted values, where the curve will be mapped with the dots, right, just on the curve, and it is overfitted there. So no values are outside the curve or inside the curve. Whereas in the first diagram, the curves are more above the line or below the line. So the center or the middle graph represents the good fit or the robust fit, where the graphical representation is there with the dots just along with the or on the curve. Now there are rule post pruning. So first we have discussed about reduced error pruning. Second method is rule post pruning, right? So in rule post pruning, there are four different rules. So first rule is to create the decision tree from the training set. So we need to create a decision tree from the training set. Second rule is to convert the tree into equivalent sets of rules. So we need to convert the tree into equivalent sets of rules. So each path corresponds to a rule, and each node along a path corresponds to a precondition, right? And each leaf classification to the post condition. So each path will correspond to a rule, each path along with each node along a path corresponds to a precondition, and each leaf classification will be the post condition. Next, third post rule pruning is prune to generalize each rule by removing those preconditions whose removal improves accuracy over the validation set or the training set with the pessimistic statistically inspired measure. Then the last rule is sort the rules in estimated order of accuracy and consider them in a sequence when classifying new instances. So this is how conversion of the rules will be implemented, that is for the same decision tree representation outlook, where outlook will be sunny and humidity will be high, then you will say playing tennis will be not possible. That is no. When outlook is sunny and humidity is too high means then you cannot go and play tennis. So why we need to convert the rules? So why we need to convert the rules means for each distinct path which produces a different rule, a condition removal may be based on the local criteria. So node pruning is global and affects all the rules. So in the rule forum, so tests are not ordered. There is no bookkeeping involved when conditions are removed. That means nodes are removed. So converting rules improves readability for humans. Now when we deal with the continuous valued attributes or dealing with the continuous valued attributes, so far the discrete values for attributes and for the outcome we have discussed, and given a continuous valued attribute like A is dynamically created with a new attribute A of C, right? So A of C will be true if A is lesser than C, right? False otherwise. C is nothing but the threshold value. So that C is nothing but a threshold value. So how to determine that threshold value C? Say for example, the temperature in the playing tennis is temperature is 40, 80, 60, 72, 80 and 90. Playing tennis will be no, no, and 54, yes, yes, and yes, yes, 85 and no. Now if you determine the candidate, the threshold, by averaging the consecutive values, then there will be a change in the classification. That means 48 plus 60 divided by 2 will be 54. That is marked in the red color there, 54. And 80 plus 90 divided by 2 will be 84. Now, if you evaluate the candidate threshold, that is the attributes according to the information gain, so the best is temperature is greater than 54. The new attribute completes with the other ones. So A of C, right? That is continuous valued attribute. A of C will be true if A is less than C. Otherwise, it will be false. Now, there is a problem with information gain, because Problems with information gain is with respect to natural bias of information gain. It favors the attributes with many possible values, and it considers the attribute date in play tennis example, where date would have highest information gain since it perfectly separates the training data, and it would be selected at the root, resulting in a very broad state and very good on the training. So this tree would be performed poorly in predicting unknown instances overfitting. So for unknown instances, this will be unpredictable. So the problem is that the partition is too specific. So too many small classes are generated. So when unspecific or more classes are there, then it cannot be predicted. So we need to look at alternative measures. So one alternative measure is gain ratio. So gain ratio is split the information gain. So splitting the information gain is S, A. So when you split the information gain, then Si are the sets of obtained by partitioning the value of I of A, that is information of A, attributes A. So split information is the measure of entropy of S with respect to the values of A, that is the attribute. The more uniformity will be there. So that is uniformly dispersed the data at its higher. That is, the gain ratio will be like split information, that is S and the attribute A. So gain of S, A by the split information S of A, right? So then the gain information will penalize the attributes that splits the examples in many small classes, such as date. Let S be denoted belong to N values called as N. So date splits the examples in N classes. Similarly, if you compare with A, then which splits the data into two even classes, that is split information S, A. Now next is you need to go for adjusting the gain ratio. So problem is like split information S, A can be 0 or very small, right? It can be between 0 and 1. So to migrate this effect, the following heuristics can be used. One is you can compute the gain for each attribute, and second one is you can apply the gain ratio only to the attributes with gain above the average or above average. Other measures is by distance based metric. So distance based metric can be used, or else by partition metrics or partition method can be used. And last one is again partition closest of the ideal partition can be used. Now handling incomplete training data. When you have training data and which is not complete, then how to cope up with the problems which will come across with respect to some of the attributes which are missing there, that is incomplete. So example, blood test result in a medical diagnosis problem, where the strategy will be used like assigning the value for most common along with the training examples of the node, and assigning the probability of each value, where based on the frequencies and assign values to those missing attributes. According to this, the probability distribution will be there, right? Now missing values in new instances to be classified are treated as treated accordingly, and the most probable classification is chosen with C4.5. Now how to handle the attributes with different costs or different weights? So in the instances, attributes may have been associated, will have an associated cost. We would prefer the decision tree that use low cost attributes. That is, ID3 can be modified to take into account cost, like by using Tan and Sklimmer. By in the 1990, they gave this formula or algorithm, that is gain square of S, A by cost of S, A. And in 1988, Nuance, or you call it as Nuance, gave an formula, that is 2 times the gain of S, A minus 1 by cost into the attribute plus 1 by W. W belongs to 0, 1.